Any other announcements? If not, we will proceed to our speaker tonight, who is Margaret Goldstein.
Hey!
Margaret is an author, as maybe she'll show us a couple of books. She is going to be speaking on incompetence and irrational behavior and how they harm us. Without any further ado, we will hear from herself.
Incompetence and irrational behavior and how they harm us.
Say the matzo ball soup, meatball marinara.
Can I keep silence?
You ready?
Speaking on these subjects in relation to the federal government and how it operates, the business world, and the education establishment. To begin with the federal government, this is a perfect example of incompetence, as it seeks to do too much and therefore does much of everything badly. It is overextended, without question. Why, for example, is it involved in college education? It has pushed the idea that everyone and anyone should go to college. It has thus increased the demand for, and of course, the cost of college. It has stepped in research aid programs. And remember now, this is, our government is broke, okay. Totaling $140 billion, further increasing high tuition. It has been a main funder of the scandalous for-profit colleges, which promise students preparation for real careers and don't. These students graduate or leave these establishments without any help at all. Why are students directed to these outfits when there are very affordable taxpayer subsidized community colleges available? What's going on here? As discussed later, it is really the state's role, not the federal government's role, to make college available in a reasonable way. And furthermore, a rational approach to post-secondary education would be properly directing students into what's actually relevant to their abilities and interests from early on in their education career. Per the German model, perhaps folks have heard about that, which successfully gets post-school students into the workforce and has a low unemployment rate among young people. The federal government also has a role both in creating a huge health problem and paying for it, paying the medical costs resulting. Exploding obesity results in serious medical problems, now even causing chronic conditions of old age in young children. The federal government raised food stamp spending from $30 billion in 2007 to $78 billion in 2011, despite the fact that joblessness was being reduced. And monthly benefits now for a family of four are about $668. How this is possible, I can't figure out, because our family of four, of course we shop at Aldi's and such places, spends $240 per month, and we're well fed. And we have fruits and vegetables and all that, which they're always trying to say people are deprived of. The Department of Agriculture has thwarted efforts to limit use of food stamps to nutritious foods. That is, one can buy candy and cookies and all other kinds of obese crowds and things. It pushes free school lunches and breakfasts on everyone. What sense does it make to push overeating on a population that as a result is getting obese, causing terrible health problems for which Medicare and Medicaid has to pay?
Yeah,
we'll see. The federal government's fiscal policies are a horror story and really, really irrational. Let me say this. It acts as a budgeting for everything, and balancing budgets is impossible. And yet, it loses over $1 trillion in revenue to giveaways, otherwise known as tax credits and deductions to special interest groups and such. Every year, it throws $1 trillion down the drain. For fiscal year 2016, the budget deficit is expected to be, and it has been going up, $549 billion. Except for losing over $1 billion in revenue, we would not have a budget deficit, and we would have a surplus. Simple math. And another situation with federal government, by requiring maternity leave, the government encourages mothers of small children to remain in the workforce, even as technology eliminates many factory and middle income office jobs left and right, leaving that much more competition for available jobs. Now to go on to incompetence and irrationality in the business community. Greed is totally irrational. It makes no sense at all, because how much money can any one person or family or even their descendants use? Republican tax cuts starting under President Reagan gave the green light to sudden huge increases in CEO compensation, which previously had been thought to be unacceptable as far as business culture was concerned. With lower taxes taking a bite from earnings, why not rake in all the more money, as much money as we can? I mean, that's their thinking. By lowering taxes on dividends, the second Bush administration has caused companies to allot more of their profits to dividends and less to investment and wages, which are what help our economy. Because by, again, having your dividends taxed less, you're going to want more of them. So much for the Republican argument that lower taxes encourage more investment. How many times have we heard that baloney? It is incompetent of business to not analyze possible consequences of what they do before doing it. Yet they don't. Business foists new products on society without first assessing if they will be harmful. Thus we have the internet. Hacking is one problem, of course, and it leading to crime and use by terrorists to launch attacks, plus its effect on the minds of young people, losing their ability to focus on ideas as they jump around the internet, so I've heard. Plus, mainstreaming news, allowing crackpot ideas to take the place of legitimate ideas and legitimate information. And then there are smartphones, and of course, we've already had a speaker about smartphones, which is very good, guarding people's attention, and of course, the whole thing of distracted driving and all that. Another irrational business practice, it is irrational for housing developers to tear up valuable agricultural land to create sprawled-out housing reachable only by cars, with each car spewing out 10,000 pounds of carbon dioxide annually, greatly contributing to global warming. And of course, going every place by car only contributes all the more to obesity. Recent efforts to correct this thing I'm going to describe have been made, but the business world has been subjecting part-time, low-wage workers to irregular, unpredictable schedules, so that these folks can't even try to make ends meet by holding two part-time jobs because they never know where they're supposed to be at these places. A business and their Republican buddies don't want people on the dole. They want them to stand on their own 2 feet. Okay, well, the situation I just described, and then also, business is deliberately eliminating jobs left and right, including some well-paid, it's not just factory jobs, it's well-paid white-collar jobs, bookkeepers and such. As for factory employment, the U.S. is still producing a lot of factory goods, but not the people. Yeah. Output is up, manufacturing output in the U.S. is up 600% since 1950. But as of 2011, it took 170 workers to produce what? It took 1,000 workers in 1950. Now, as for education, why must all students take algebra? This is the most irrational. It is reasonable only in certain occupations. Is otherwise useless, is beyond the grasp of one third of students, and can discard students to the point where they drop out of high school. Teach them instead practical math, especially money management, at which the American public is so poor. They need lessons in money management. And I could go into more detail if I had more time about that. As I previously mentioned, it is the state's role to make college education available. And the states do. 71% of four-year college students go to state public colleges, subsidized by the states, so that according to the figures I have, anyway, probably someone will dispute this, but anyway, tuition and fees average $9,139 a year, and if you include room and board, it's $15,000. Average annual cost for community colleges, which are also partly subsidized by states, is $3,300. With figures like this, it's hard to believe that a lot of families cannot be prepared for the college educations of their kids. Nevertheless, 71% were told our four-year college graduates have an average of $35,000 in debt. And how is this possible when only 29% go to the very expensive private colleges? I don't know. Why does a broke state like Illinois, which provides scholarship money, in addition to the substantial amount of college subsidies? College subsidies are enough. Why are politicians touting the idea that taxpayer money should provide free schooling to each and every four-year-old child?
Let's say for now.
They never properly funded Head Start, and yet they want to do this, but what's the increased chances of, but what has been found is you really do not need to be educated every 4 year old, but you do need to educate and help the underprivileged, but not from four, it's too late. You need to start them in infancy. And this type of funding and money should go to the truly needy, not just everybody's 4 year old. So if you go to as I understand it, this science has established this at a very young age, as they say, as in infancy, and you work on them from that very young age, you may be able to help them.
The government raises children?
Finally, in conclusion, one recommendation I have to make the federal government at least more competent and rational is to remove the functions it handles so badly, including higher education, medical care, and food programs. Obamacare is a nightmare, and prior to it, Massachusetts had its own state government-provided system. Let us turn to each state to develop its own system, hopefully a much better single-payer system. Medicare is going broke, so provide seniors with some coverage along the way in this new state system. Examples of where the federal government, good examples of where the federal government has failed, where the states have been able to do things. Federal government has been unable to institute gun control. But seven states have. Several states have started tap and trade programs to reduce greenhouse gases, whereas the federal government was unable to do that. Now, we know how stymied the federal government is anyway, and it's been proved there are so many of these things they can't do, including managing our federal lands, public lands. 40% of all coal produced in this country is from federal lands. For example, Washington has armies of lobbyists from food companies, colleges, and insurance companies. So, get them out of these areas of endeavor, and you will disperse, hopefully, some of these lobbies. Centralization of government functions in the federal government has allowed centralization of lobbying efforts in this one place, Washington, D.C. If they had to go to 50 different places, it might be harder. Let the federal government concentrate on nationwide issues, such as enforcing antitrust laws. The law in enforcing these laws has allowed more mergers and acquisitions in 2015 than ever before. And business concentration can lead to harmful monopolies, harming all of us. Instead of promoting college for everyone, and a school for all 40-year-olds, perhaps President Obama should be enforcing our antitrust laws.
No.
That's it?
That's it.
Okay.
Yay! All right. I'm going to give you the first question, Margaret. What is it? Does the federal government do anything good?
Yes.
Can you elaborate on the functions that it does good?
Dodd-Frank is being very well. They are
can
really
you use the
going,
mic, please?
Oh, sorry. They're really going after the banks in a big, good way. And the EPA does a good job, too, from what I understand. I probably have to think a long time to think of anything else, but I'm sure there are some things they do. Well, you have disaster relief. I mean, they come in, you know, when there are disasters. They have the, I'm going to think of the name of it, you know, that group, the disease control group.
Centers for Disease Control.
Yeah, they're very good. They do good stuff. But the whole point I'm trying to make is they're in too many, they have their hand finger in too many pies. I mean, they're doing too many different things. That's my message.
Hey, Judy Crownerville.
Yes. Okay, you said the EPA was great. I generally agree. Well, then why did they screw up so badly with Flint, as did the state government in Michigan?
Yeah, and
it didn't foresee what was
going to
happen.
Well,
yeah, I really couldn't answer that. I think it was a Chicago office of it that did. I can't really speak to that. I mean, that's kind of a particular situation. But I was just talking broadly that I know that they do enforce, environmental laws, and they do studies, and they this thing now, what is it, it's to get the coal, cut down on coal, carbon dioxide emissions from coal plants. They're involved in that now, and that's very important.
Okay.
So,
is if I can't look at you because the sun is right.
Okay, well, I'm over here.
Yes,
no, he's
see you, Don.
Okay, Margaret, I wanted to ask you, you said that you're against the government, the federal government being involved in healthcare, and you've also declared Medicare failure, and you have said that you oppose the Affordable Care Act, aka Obamacare. Now I just wanted to ask you, I'm guessing, I don't know your exact age, but I am guessing that you probably are eligible for Medicare. So what I'm asking you, Margaret, is this. Would you be willing to give up your Medicare altogether and buy private health insurance in a no longer regulated market? Would you be willing to do that, ma'am?
I think you kind of misunderstood me. I'm not against Medicare as such, and I'm not saying it's a failure. I was saying that it's broke. And I was saying because when I'm advocating for state control of medical care, people are going to say, well, what would happen to Medicare? And so that would have to be provided for. You're still going to, but I would think that, so I have nothing against Medicare, and I think seniors and everybody else, of course, should be covered, but preferably with single payer, which is a much better system. Obamacare is a nightmare. I mean, it's not the concept I'm against. It's how badly done. And I mean, complain after complain about it, including the red tape.
But Margaret, let's assume that. Okay, let's just suppose for a moment. You haven't really answered my question. What I'm asking you to suppose for a moment that you have two choices. We either go back to how things were before the Affordable Care Act got passed, or we maintain status quo.
We don't go back. We substitute a better system than Obamacare. You have to choose. Those are the only two choices. Having the government involved in providing medical care.
But you're not answering my question about whether you prefer that we go back or would you prefer that we stay. No, I never want to go back.
I never said that. I said something, and everybody is saying this. We've got to have something, a better way of doing it than Medicare.
Obamacare.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Carol
Elliger. Margaret, you probably know that the FICA tax is taxed on the first $1,018,500. So even Rahm Emanuel, Ken Griffin, who's the richest man in Illinois, They're only taxed up to that point for the FICA tax. Anything above that is not taxed for FICA tax, all right? And yet, if we would eliminate the cap on the FICA tax, it would free up money and we would have all the money we would need for Medicare. Now, there's other things that we need to consider too, and that is the tax on things that caused us to get ill, such as tobacco, alcohol, sugar, all of those, and there's some more things that I could list, but those are the three. Those are enough.
I don't have any argument here. I'm with
okay.
you.
Okay. And if those, if that problem. Money, just a minute, and if that money went for an improved Affordable Care Act for everybody, we would have enough money to fund it because it would save us money.
Okay.
It would save us money by, and Tom Dart, who is the Cook County Sheriff, thank you, has said the jails are not mental hospitals, and yet this is where we're putting mentally ill people. If we had improved Affordable Care Act or single-payer health care for everybody, it would be cheaper to treat those people than putting them in jails, which is costing us anywhere the minimum of $35,000 up to $55,000 a year. So there are things that we can do to improve it.
Okay, a brief reminder that
I agree with everything you say,
but this
and
is a question, period.
And I want to point out, but I do agree, I mean, I could have said the same thing. And I, in fact, and Jane and I were in a fiscal reform group, and this is one of the big points we were trying to make, to raise, eliminate the cap on the payroll tax deductions for the payroll taxes. And there's no sense to it. Everybody's been saying it, even some members of Congress, and they never do eliminate it. But it's a cap, like you say, it's up to
$118,500.
Yeah, okay. So absolutely, that's the most common sense, rational thing anybody could do. It's not going to hurt anybody. I mean, it's just like the same thing with the federal government has almost eliminated the...
So can I just ask, then I misunderstood. I got to ask a question. The question, who do you think is opposed to that?
Eliminating
the cap.
I don't know. We have not. I mean, I've heard members of Congress say they want to.
The rich people, the very rich party.
Apparently, it's the anti-tax folks, because the Republicans are against any tax. So raising any tax is also taboo, I guess. That's all I can think of. They're against any tax. But they have almost eliminated the inheritance tax. The federal level, if you have to like really have leave millions and millions and millions, and that is another campaign. Why? What a harmless tax that is, really.
Okay. All right, that was an excellent point. This is a question period. All right, Charlie.
Yes, Margaret, you keep saying that things should be done by the states instead of the federal government. However, the civil service employees of the federal government are certainly more qualified than those in the state. You have to pay 50 state employees, and you could pay one federal employee. You said you're saving money with today's communications and the internet, and administratively, you could have 10 centers instead of 50 states. And I have yet to hear any one reason why this inherently is better done at the local level instead of the federal level. You have to give me a reason. Give me a reason why it is more efficient. I have never seen this in civil service in 35 years where they are different.
I'm trying to say, first of all, I don't agree that federal workers are better than state. I'm going to
throw
it, but that's beside the point. What I'm trying to say, for these specific areas, education especially, education is clearly being taken care of by the state.
Why?
The state, 71% go to state subsidized colleges. Come on, I mean, if you want people to have access to...
There are only 2,400 colleges.
You're supposed to be listening to my...
One federal agency.
Obamacare is a mess. Education is handled on the federal way is plain stupid. Plain stupid. They have gone ahead and got everybody thinking everybody has to go to college. Then this thing where they're not, the for-profit colleges being subsidized
What's
by the federal law is
what
insane.
Rule?
It's insane.
What rule that says you have to go to college?
That's the federal government.
Well,
if our president Obama and Bush and the other guys said that once the
What's the rule?
Time,
all right. What's the law?
The rule is one fool at a time, Charlie.
What's the law, Paul, that says children have to go to college?
You can work on it.
All right.
There's no law.
Next question.
All right.
What are they, arrest children?
What?
Go to college?
No.
Who got your tongue? Somebody has a question.
All right, he does.
Barbara, I'd like to ask this question. A lot of people say that, especially big business, is centered on short-term profits rather than long-term profits. You think this has something to do with your topic?
You're absolutely right, it is. And that's what I was saying, that the thing of lowering taxes on dividends, as Bush did, he increased the focus of companies on taking their profits and giving them over to dividends. So, wait a minute, I get to...
Yeah, I asked if a lot of people say that big business centers on short-term profits.
How much can we bring in dividends? I mean, we cut pay here, or we don't raise pay, and we don't invest, and it's harming our economy. And yes, they are definitely focusing more on short-term profits and not helping the country.
Or themselves.
No, they are helping themselves.
Okay.
Well, that's the question of whether it's management that's helping itself or the transitory investors or the firm is actually building itself up to better serve the public. Well, yes, Tim Bowles.
Why is it that every irrational thing the government does happens to be a conservative cause, and everything the government does well happens to be a liberal cause?
What's the difference between a conservative and a liberal? Liberals are right.
The irrational things are a conservative cause, and the sensible things, I don't know the answer, but it's a good question. I have to think. Come on.
Do you have an answer?
Well, that's as far as thinking.
To elaborate, it just seems that everything you're talking that the government does irrationally, like providing subsidized and universal health care, even though Obamacare may not be something. Why is it irrational the government provide health care? Otherwise...
No. I didn't say that was irrational. No, I said it has to be done better.
Well,
no, I absolutely believe in that. I support that. But the things, as I said, about pushing the for-profit colleges, that's a conservative breaking the money issue. So that's irrational, and it's pro-conservative. Supporting giving these for-profit colleges. They're a horror story. Everybody can see they're advertised on TV. That's taxpayer money paying for those commercials. It's wrong. I mean, they're supposed to be going after these for-profit colleges of federal government, but they're not making much progress, apparently.
Okay.
Well, I have a question. That is, why should I be shopping at for my Braunschweiger at Oakley rather than some other emporium? Shopping for my Braunschweiger at Aldi rather than some other store.
Oh, is that a food you're talking about?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. At Aldi because it's cheap. Because Aldi is very, very reasonable, folks. If you haven't been there, we spend $40 a week to get all our basic groceries at Aldi's. And then the odds and ends, we get $20 more out of stores. But it is absolutely affordable. I'm so grateful that you're there. You don't have to shop at these huge jewels, the tools where it takes day long even to find anything.
Okay, y'all.
Okay. All right.
That's all right.
All right. Any other questions? We have plenty of time.
Can I have a second one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I'll make it short. Margaret, you wrote a book, The Selfishness System. Does this have anything to do with your topic?
Well, obviously all these things are based on selfishness. But my point in this was to point out that just calling us selfish doesn't change anything, but maybe you can point out how stupid and irrationally things are.
Right, I know. The cashier was busy. I couldn't pay a cashier, but I'll give it to you. Okay, well, as long as you can come.
Oh, yes.
How would you respond to somebody like the fictional character who said that greed is good?
As I said, greed is bad.
One of the seven deadly sins.
Money is the root of all evil.
Love of money.
We see how much damage is done by greedy people, but as I say, at the same time, what's even the point of it? I mean, how much money can you use? What's the point? So yeah, greed is bad. It's morally bad. I believe that, you know, what's the seven deadly sins or whatever, isn't it? One of them is avarice. What is the thing about in the Bible? I don't mean to be quoting the Bible. What is the rich man can the cat get through the eye of a needle or something? You know, all this stuff. It's always been considered something questionable.
It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter heaven.
Okay, good. Thank you. That's good. So it's always been,
letting God rule you is a little bit of water. It's not my thing. It's water. Your friends are. Yes.
Can I ask one more question?
Carol.
Margaret, you said that it's very irrational for the state's government, the federal government, to be subsidizing colleges and universities and expecting everybody to go to college. Do you think that possibly the banks, with their student loans, and industry has some responsibility or is accountable for any of this?
Definitely, yeah, because it's like, let's hide the fact that people can easily, 71% can easily go to an affordable college, and let's say, you have to go to Harvard or something so that you can then loan money to them and rake in the interest. You're right, it's probably holding back people thinking rationally about this. It's these selfish interest groups, as Kim referred to, but they don't see themselves as what they're doing is so irrational.
All right, Don Ritchie.
Okay, Margaret, you were speaking out against free school lunches for children earlier in your lecture, and I wanted to ask you, are you against free school lunches for poor kids in public school?
Don, you might be amazed to realize that every single child in Chicago public schools gets a free lunch.
Oh, okay.
It's got nothing to do with meat. Of course, there should be free. And they also used to have not just free lunches, but low-cost lunches. That would probably be the best thing. You always want to have people taking some role in supplying for them, providing for themselves. So even if you pay a quarter for your lunch, you're taking some. You're giving the child a better lesson. But don't forget that these kids are getting these free lunches and breakfasts in addition to the fact that their families are raking in the food stamps. So it's kind of double.
I don't think so.
Well, maybe that's a
are you saying that every parent of every child in CPS is eligible for
food
stamps?
Yes, they are.
Okay, that's okay. Yeah, she just said that all the kids come.
No, I don't think so.
Recent years, something that was somehow, I can't remember this. They have some rationalization for it, but of course it's nonsense, but they rationalize it.
All right, Charles?
Yeah, Margaret, you said that that start was too late, and the training of children by the government should begin earlier, like when they're 1 year, like, babies to be taken? I don't understand this.
No, the way they do it, I've heard of a pilot program in West Virginia. What they have is like visiting, I don't know if you call them teachers, but visiting personnel. They go to these poor homes, and then right away they're working with the baby and his mother, and they're just changing the culture from day one. That's what they're doing.
So you have a government agent go to each mother's house to see that a child is raised properly?
I didn't understand what?
A government agent go goes to
yeah,
each house to see that a mother is doing raising the child properly?
Yes. You need to intervene in these troubled families.
At all households.
Well, I mean, if you want to solve society's, you know, the problems in that area.
I'm doing the best I can.
Judy, are you giving birth to that question?
What do you do if you have a kid who's a ward of the state and state agencies are already supposed to be checking on that child and they don't because they're overburdened? They're already overburdened and understaffed.
Yeah.
So we don't fund it.
Absolutely. I mean, this Department of Children and Family Services should be properly done. I know this from personal experience, so I know. We adopted a son who was in their under their auspices, and they did nothing. Yeah, okay.
What about the role of the military and our security services and police? What should they do better? And what do they do bad now?
In police, obviously, they have to be better supervised. They have to get in Chicago and I guess elsewhere, get away from protecting the bad policemen. Apparently there's only a handful of really bad policemen who are brutal and all that. You cannot allow them to continue. You can't cover up for them. You have to have them brought to, you have to fire them, is what you do. So you have to have a police department that's better, in my opinion, you know, they were getting a new police commissioner for Chicago. And one of the candidates was a man who was a psychologist or had a psychology background. In my opinion, that's what we need. We have to have somebody that knows the psychology of dealing with these troubled areas on the West Side. So that's what I think. And as far as the military, I can't really answer that. I mean, I know, but the Pentagon is a mess as far as their, I don't know about actual military operations, but I know the Pentagon is, of course, horribly overfunded. It's up to like $500-600 billion a year. They waste money left and right. And it's again, it's a special interest group. Producing weapons we don't need. It's making, doing, they spend, I think, $70 billion a year developing more and more and complicated weapons so they have an excuse to produce them. I mean, the whole thing is a mess. I don't know about military operations.
Do you have any solutions to these problems that government's doing?
Well, yeah, my solution, I mean, the basic theme of this was to get the federal government from having things all extended, to take some of those functions away from the federal government. I mean, it's a big, I don't want to sound like a Republican, but it really seems like it's a government that's out of control. And I don't know, I didn't have the time to study or anything, how other federal governments do. You know, other countries that have a federal system, whether they give more authority to their states than we do, I don't know. But it seems to me we originally did have. And it's just common sense to me when you see the states running, the state, the colleges, they, and many states have many, so we have what, in Illinois, 8 or 10 or something, state colleges, and California has God knows how many, and state of New York, so they're doing the job, so get the federal government out of it, and you get away from, we should not be funding for-profit colleges, it's not right. So that's a change that I would, I mean, there are a lot of things, I mean, you can have, get rid of gerrymandering, and get better state legislatures, and have term limits. I mean, a lot of these things I've talked about for years in various places, you do have to have term limits. You can't have these jokers in office decade after decade after decade. I mean, so it's in Congress, and people can be only way up in years. And they're still there.
Should we ask Jean?
So we're on questions, right? Okay,
so you want a constitutional convention to institute a rearrangement of the federal government in order to farm out some of the responsibilities?
I don't know that you have to require a constitutional convention or amendment, because you do some things like term limits, you have to, but as far as
Thanks.
As far as...
I don't even know if their hand is up for me or for you.
Okay, as far as the federal government to get them out of the politicians, I'm sure you don't need customs of them. I mean, it's just a matter of pulling back to get out, or even Obamacare. I mean, you see, and I think everybody was saying, I need to change Obamacare. It is not working. It's really a mess. It's not working. You have providing insurance, but yeah, but folks are paying premiums of $300 a month and then having $6,000 deductibles. What kind of coverage is that?
That's
what the system, well, I mean, it's not doing anything for anybody as far as I can. It's just, I can't really cover everybody.
Oh, all right. LPN. And
In all your travels research, did you run across any information showing that Obamacare was largely written by the insurance company? It wasn't Obama's idea to come out with that.
I'm
something.
Pretty sure you're right.
This was a big
one. Yeah, I don't exactly, but I've heard that they had a lot of influence. And the whole thing, and there were so many compromises because they wanted to please the insurance industry, and that's probably
and
why
it
was such
is.
A nightmare. Yeah, yeah.
There
but everybody
is.
Was saying if you just had single payer, that would have been... Look, Britain is a country that almost everything is the same as it is here, except they have, and Canada too, except they have a single payer system. Works fine, same culture, same language. Why can't we have that?
To rebut that, I would not say.
Okay, we have a rebuttal period at the end of the question period. You'll have plenty of time. You'll have.
I thought this was the rebuttal.
No. You'll have.
One.
We will have.
Let me be that fool. Liam, this is a question.
I understand.
Is it a question or?
I had a question, but I forgot it in the race to discredit it.
Well, you can always bring it up.
From the sound of everyone else, I thought this was the
rebuttal.
All right.
Because our speaker gets the final word, and she might respond to
here's
your
somebody, here's a new
question.
Face over here.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a new I think you have a lot of issues that I support, but one of the things you haven't brought up is that, you know, we talk about capitalism and communism in this country, but we don't really talk about the essence of what it is. And what we've got here is a rigged market. It's not capitalistic. It's an oligopoly?
Oligarchy.
Okay. So you've got the government subsidizing these monocrop agricultures that come up with this crap called corn fructose and all this other stuff, and then they put that into the food, and we all get diabetes and a whole bunch of other diseases, and nobody ever wants to look at the real cause of something. So, you know, I guess what I'm saying is, you want to fix Obamacare, then you got to get rid of the racket. You got to get rid of the people that are paying Congress to support this stuff.
That's exactly like what Andy was saying, that the insurance companies were given a big say in growing up, and that's another thing.
But
that's probably why it's so irrational. Makes no sense.
It's with everything, though. It's with the insurance companies. It's with the utility companies. It's with everything. And until you can stop the payoffs to Congress, nothing in this country is going to get fixed.
Well, then Congress is really in the strong, like you say, in the grips of the special interest groups. That's why another reason to take some of this stuff away from Congress.
Yes.
Because that's where all the special interest groups are going. And
you can't, special interest groups can't go to state?
What?
They go to state as well.
Yeah, but you're going to go to 50 states versus one place.
Well,
the point is that everybody that we allegedly elect is on the take. That's the issue.
What's that? I'm sorry.
The people that we allegedly elect
I'm not getting
us,
my take.
They're on the take, and we're not going to...
Yeah, they represent the special interest groups, no question. And
not
the
us.
Common good.
All right. Let's...
Yes.
Ron, I get this now. It's question time, right?
Right, but we'll be going to rebuttal
there
soon.
There are. You were saying that it's kind of a waste of time for everybody to expect everybody to go to college. Do you think police officers should be required to have a college education, a degree, say
yes,
in
should.
Criminology, psychology, something like that?
I'm not really sure. I think, was it somewhere I read that they are requiring 2 years of college for them? I'm not... Possibly 2 years of college. I don't know that they should have
to
have a
academy. They go to the police academy.
Yeah,
for
I know
one
that.
Year.
Yeah, I know that. Is that a year?
Just what?
That's a year?
Yeah.
All right. Well, that doesn't sound like a bad. I don't know. I'm not sure what the answer is to that.
Let's cut off early and go to rebuttals.
Wait, I have one more question.
I remember the question.
All right.
In this case, your earlier comment about like who's telling everybody they have to go to college doesn't like your line about like the schools that like the 29% that go to the expensive colleges doesn't really fit in with the general reality that tuition has been increasing by hundreds of percentage points a decade. And basically, I think the official stat is that Harvard, if you were to work your way through college on the minimum wage. In 1965, it would take you 5 hours of work a day to attend Harvard, and today it would be 20 hours a day of solid work. Like, this is like, people's college funds simply don't, it's completely evaporated. I'm attending right now. This stuff is, that's the massive sea change, is that costs don't.
I'm going to private college?
No, a public college. And it's still through the roof.
Yeah.
These like that's my question about this is, I don't think that's the right issue here that we're talking about. That why should student loans be a problem is because the money is a problem.
You understand that the state government's highly separate. It's true they cut funding for public colleges, but there's still a major part of it paid for by the state. As you would know, if you compare the tuition of say $9,000 with tuition in Harvard, is obviously a lot of the tuition is subsidized by the state. And I
even
say it's a whole idea of helping people go to college. I think it's a fair system.
Barely amounts to much. Have you seen like
it's not a down one full at
okay.
a time.
All right. Anybody else that have any questions?
I have a question.
Probably take it.
Well,
just real brief. It's not a state speech.
One quick question.
Okay, Margaret. Why is it the state role to provide college for students and not the federal role?
As I said, the state is doing it well, and the federal government is not. That's it.
All right.
Okay,
Brom?
Let's thank our speaker.
All right. We got a rebuttal period coming up.
She has the final word, so.
Okay.
Who's got your
so restful?
The first rebuttal. Thank you, Gene.
One moment. We need to apportion time for this for our rebuttal.
I think we could just.
How many have rebuttal comments to make to the rest of us? One, two, three, four.
Somebody
else may be inspired.
Let's go until 6 minutes each.
Let's make it half an hour each.
No.
Maximum 6 minutes.
6 minutes. Well, 5 minutes.
You want to go five, Brom?
Yeah, try for five.
Okay.
I'll get the end.
All right, Gene, go ahead.
Okay, I guess I got the first rebuttal. I'm going to talk about two things. Tim, please give me when I'm within a minute. I hope I'll be brief.
I will.
I'm going to talk about the healthcare system, the education system. I agree with what Margaret said, that not everybody needs to go to college. They need to get an education of some sort. Many should go to a vocational training. Junior college, I went to junior college. Of course, maybe that's not in its favor, but I would recommend junior college and public college. Let me give you one example of my friend Francois Johnson's a grandson went to college. He dropped out. His mom wanted to go to college. She didn't really show an interest in it. And after that, he sat around for about a year, and then she spent $1,000 sending him to a security school. Excellent idea. At least he's working now. Yeah, he's not making much money, but he's making 10 bucks an hour, and which he wasn't making anything after he went to college. So I would say vocational training in something, and you know, he was a guy who wanted to make money. Well, at least, you know, he's making something. So I think the vocational training is good, regardless of who pays for it. It shouldn't be a money maker for the rich. But the second thing is on health care. On health care, I would say maybe Obamacare is not good because it the insurance companies make a fortune out of it, but I know somebody in the audience who has three or four kids, and they're all getting Obamacare where they didn't get any before. And I've got three relatives who got nothing before, and now they're all poor as church mice, and they're getting Obamacare, so it's better than nothing. I would favor single payer. Single payer would be a really great system. It's like our Medicare now. I got Medicare now, and I think it's a very efficient system, a very rational system, and I've had very little problems with it. So I think that ought to be extended, and that would not be in the hands of the insurance industry and a bunch of vultures trying to make a lot of money. Thank you.
You know, Margaret, what I heard tonight is not a bunch of irrational behavior, but a litmus test of what you think the government's doing wrong and right, which in a lot of ways I tended to disagree with.
Well, you would.
Well, of course I would, because we know what works. For example, let's talk about our economy and business. The system of capitalism and markets work. Why is it, for example, that some people, like the bread driver, gets up really early in the morning at 5 o'clock to go deliver bread? It's not because he's feeling nice to everybody. It's because he has a job to get the bread to the markets by 8 o'clock in the morning so that people can spend money. And they know that fresh bread is available at 8 o'clock so that you can get in there. He don't want to get up at 5 o'clock. He doesn't do it for the rationality of the other person. He does it because he has a job and he has to be up at 5 o'clock to meet the needs of the market. Why is it, for example, that a bank loans out money? They do it not for the good of the individuals, but they do it to make money for the banks, and they hire people to help them make money.
Why do people work in coal mines?
Charlie, the people work in coal mines to provide power and electricity and the necessities of life for others. Businesses feed markets to make money for their shareholders. And if that's not an efficient system, I don't know what is. Because the value of goods is determined by the price. The demand for the goods is determined by who buys them and who does not. Good businesses that grow use efficient practices. Those that don't falter. I agree with you. We shouldn't be subsidizing large corporations. But you know, there are certain things that government does well as well. You know, providing health care may be one of them. I do know we have a for-profit health system here in this country. Every other country in the world has some form of nationalized health care. Now, I don't know if Obamacare is going to do it, but perhaps maybe we could look at a VA as a decent model. Well, I'm getting good care through the VA myself.
I'm glad you are.
And, you know, there will be things done, but, you know, you also have to understand that with the revolution of information technology that's been going on, the computerization of the world, the smartphone, that camera up there that I'm using to record this, they're all good things. They're all good things to use. You know, and the one thing that many environmentalists don't understand is that if you really want to green up the world, you're almost irrational if you don't support nuclear power. Because of the... Now, let me put it to you this way. Rationally, if I could get a lifetime supply of energy in a module the size this big, we should be subsidizing it. We should be researching it. We should be using it to power our sense more. And I'm not the only one who thinks that way. There are some former people out of Greenpeace who think that we should be looking at nuclear power. And if you really want to look at it, we know how to make people prosperous. I think the first thing is a good stable food supply, climate, and agriculture. And we've had a good revolution in the 60s with getting agriculture ready, better. It used to be 50 to 60% of the people worked in agriculture in the late 18th to early 19th to late 19th century. Now there's less than 4%. And what are the rest of us doing? Many other things. The second thing that runs people that helps them prosper is the abundance of electric power and energy sources that fuel an industrial economy. Most of these environmentalists would rather have us go back to the glories of the workers, you know, that Stalin and these guys did, but I don't know a single guy who works in an African village who would not want something like a washing machine or electric power or lights. And the third thing that really helps around the world is basically when people cooperate. And one of the best forms of cooperation is free and open trade. Not this rigged system we got now, but free and open trade. Globalization has been a good thing. It has helped more people with more jobs and with more providing more goods than any other so-called government or wealth breakup program around the world. If you don't believe me, all you got to do is just look at the statistics of GNP of growing countries. Look at the amount of people living better today than it was even 15 years ago. They're talking about eradication of abject poverty in less than 15 years or 30 years, according to the UN. Why? Because we're putting free market principles into place around the world, providing cheaper goods to more people with cheaper production costs. And when you have that, you also get more jobs because people will have more things they need done. Anyway, efficiency, yeah, there's a few problems. Corruption, yes, I agree, and it needs to be taken care of. But, come on.
All right.
Come on.
Okay. Done. Okay. Unpopular, yes.
David Zucker, followed by Don Rickey.
I would like to disassociate myself from most of what was just said by the last speaker.
Good! Good! And you're wrong!
With regard to capitalism, the only reason why I'm for it is because everything else that's been tried is, for the most part, so much worse. I have no desire to see, for example, Stalinism revived and most of the other models haven't worked either. But to portray capitalism as an unbridled blessing, I'm not having any of that. And as I said to Tim earlier, why is it that the stuff that the government that does right is liberal? And why is it that the stuff that the government does wrong is conservative? Because everything liberal is good and everything conservative is bad.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, I must also take issue with some of the comments that our speaker made tonight. I agree with most of what she said. But I do think there's a role for the federal government in subsidizing education. I don't know that everybody has to go to college, but I benefited from going to college. And I think that police officers benefit from going to college because it makes them better educated, better adjusted, and more sensitive to the community at large. And as to turning it over to the states, well, if you think corruption's bad at the federal level, the state, they ain't got nothing on what goes on at the state level.
Yeah.
I mean, they seem to forget that it wasn't that long ago state legislators, in order to make money, used to introduce in Springfield what they called a Fetcher bill. And what this did, well, let me give you an example of one. A legislator might introduce a bill in the Illinois House or Senate that would require that every railroad tie in this state be laid so many inches apart. That would immediately bring to Springfield lobbyists from the railroads. It would fetch them to Springfield, hence the name Fetcher Bill, with envelopes to be distributed to key legislators to make sure that this bill never got out of committee. So, I'm sorry, I don't think that good things can be left to the states alone. The federal government has a role in subsidizing education and supervising it to make sure that the states do a good job.
And don't forget Crook County.
I never forget Crook County. I used to work there. Although, to be sure, there wasn't any crookedness in the office where I worked. If I had, I wouldn't have agreed to work there. And with regard to nuclear power, they have never figured out what to do with the waste. They have never they cut too many corners after Admiral Rickover stopped overseeing nuclear power and went back to the Navy.
Yeah.
And as a result, it became a mess. Safety was compromised, and as I said, they couldn't figure out what to do with the waste. I've repeated ad nauseum here. When I was in high school, when Commonwealth Edison built that huge plant in Zion, promising us years and years of cheap electricity, with those commercials with that little light bulb that looked like a bird. Little Bill! Well, folks, it ain't so little now.
That's right. Great
rebuttal. Thank you.
All right, Sid.
It was said that the capitalism is the only system that works.
It does.
Yet, if you look around you, you have roads, you have bridges, you have all kinds of infrastructure, and it was built not by capitalism, but by people working together in order to construct all these various projects. So it's a form of socialism when everybody works together. And then we have capitalism, but what is capitalism doing? It's ruining the environment. It's ruining the climate. We could see that if things go on the way they've been going, we won't have a planet to live on. So if you keep going with capitalism, you won't have any life on this earth.
Right.
So we have to find a better way. It's not a matter of thinking about ideology. It's about living on this planet with all its rich resources, plants, and food products that we get from this earth. And of course, socialism was tried to a certain degree in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe. But if you look at anything, the steamboat, the car, the airplane, there was a lot of mistakes made, and they said, we'll never fly because it's not the way that people are made up. But through technology, we learn to fly. And you always make mistakes. But what are mistakes for if not to correct them? So we had socialism that was sort of distorted for about 90 some years. But that does not mean it doesn't work. It only means that we didn't have the right circumstances, the right base for socialism. Socialism depends on a highly productive economic system. Of course, we can't have it like we used to because we need different power sources. You can't use coal, you can't use fossil fuels any longer. So we have to depend on the solar system, on the sun, we have to depend on wind power and hydropower in order to have clean energy. But if the Earth is not destroyed after a certain period of time, the only way we can get by is having a different social system. It's not a matter of, like I said, ideology, it's a matter of need.
Okay. All right. All right, I must confess that when I read the title tonight, I had absolutely no idea what Margaret was going to talk about. But, so the lecture was a surprise to me. I'd have to take issue with a lot of what Margaret said, so probably some of you realize. I actually know Margaret pretty well because, see, both Margaret and I used to be involved in the Sierra Club, and I still am involved in the Sierra Club. I haven't seen you there, Margaret, lately, but, you know, of course, I'm sure that, I don't, you know, but I'm sure if you wanted to help out again, I'm sure they'd be happy to have you. Anyway, there's, but one of the things Margaret was talking about cops, and she said that, yeah, that some cops have done bad things, and so what we need to do, I'm not exactly sure what you were talking about, but if you're talking about incidents of police using excessive violence, or what most of the public would consider excessive violence, then firing a few cops is not going to change anything. Because the reason the police almost are never convicted for shooting, let's say, unarmed men or even unarmed children, is because the current police rules of conduct allow them to do this. So they're not breaking the law. The law actually permits them to do this. So the problem isn't bad apples. The problem is the policies, the whole system. And just firing individual cops who are following what is actually standard procedure isn't going to change the procedure. Now, Margaret seemed to consider the Affordable Care Act a total failure. And she, as far as I can tell, didn't see anything good coming out of it. However, the Affordable Care Act allowed low-income people, such as myself, to get Medicaid even if we didn't have kids. Before, the only way you could get kids is if you were the parent of a dependent child. Otherwise, you were considered a loafer, you know, who should go out and buy his own medical insurance. And, right. Right. Well, yeah, that's your problem, pal, you know. And also, the other thing that the Affordable Care Act did is it banned the insurance companies from denying insurance to people based on pre-existing conditions. I personally know people who have insurance today who could not have gotten it before Obama became president. And today they're insured. And they are getting the health care they need thanks to the Affordable Care Act. Now, there aren't enough votes, even if we get a Democratic majority in the elections this year, we still are not going to have enough votes in Congress to pass a federal single payer act. So basically our choices are to maintain the current status quo until a bigger change comes in terms of who's in Congress, or to repeal Obamacare, as the Republican Party wants to do, and go back to how things were before. Now, if you repeal Obamacare, then millions of people are going to lose their insurance. Millions of people are going to suffer and die. And so, if you consider that a fair price to pay for the elimination of this evil federal program, fine. Now, Margaret said that the states are harder to buy. The state governments are harder to buy than the feds. However, the facts say otherwise, because there's an organization called ALEC, American Legislative Exchange Council, which makes it its business to go to all 50 state capitals and lobby all the state legislatures, and they do a very good job of it. Now, Tim, you said that coal miners were trying to provide power for people, and that they're trying to provide a return on investment to their shareholders. Well, the CEO might be trying to do that if it's a publicly traded company, but the coal miners are just trying to earn a living. I mean, if they could make a living that didn't involve risking their lives, some of them might want to do that. But they're just trying to put food on the table and pay their bills. they're not selflessly sacrificing themselves to the greater glory of the shareholders. Now, Sid blamed capitalism for our environmental problems, and now I would just only say one word to that, Chernobyl. But Sid did point out that socialists made mistakes. On the other hand, a person who believes in capitalism could point to the mistakes of socialism, say that these mistakes prove that socialism is a failure, and then look at the mistakes of capitalism and say, well, those are mistakes, but that doesn't mean the whole system of capitalism is bad. But this is what people do. When you're on a side, you say that the errors of your side are just mistakes. That doesn't mean the system's bad. And you point to the errors of the other side and you say, that proves that the other side is all bad. And but me, I tend to agree with Lord Acton. I think power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And when you have absolute power over other people and over everything in general, whether you are a capitalist or a socialist, you're gonna get away with murder.
Yeah. All right, Charlie.
Murder anybody.
Let's go, Charlie.
All right, I don't have a lot to say today. Anyhow, thank you, Margaret, for visiting us again and giving us plenty here to discuss. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I see there are three levels of government, federal, state, and local level. I see no reason that the federal activities should terminate and that the state is automatically and inherently going to do a better job at it. It has not been established in my mind. I see this on the current presidential campaign. They say we're going to get the federal government out of this and we're going to have the states do this. And from everywhere I've seen, and I've been in civil service for a number of years, there's no corruption at the federal level. Certainly not in the administrative field. At the state level, yes, and certainly at the local level. But you have to present an argument, a functional argument, to establish in my mind that this method is better than this one. You just say it is better, but you give me no reason why. Now I'll give you a reason why things should be maintained. Public policy and programs should be administered at the federal level. Instead of 50 states wandering around, you can have very quality, and believe you me, when people get at the federal level, they're superior to state directors of any endeavor. Far superior in any agency department. The federal government has 10 regions generally. They divvy the United States up to about 5 states each, with headquarters in 10 regional cities. And in today's modern age of email communication, paperless communication, instant communication, there's no conceivable reason whatsoever that it is simply easier to administer that. There are 2,400 colleges in the United States. I don't see why one federal department could not administer a subsidy or grant program very easily for all 2,400. That is not a taxing proposition. There's nothing done. Now here's the thing. Instead of, you want to have 50 separate programs, is what you're telling me. Now if a student transfers colleges, they've got 50 different ones that they may comply or not. If you're in a wealthy state, I guess as a college student you do good, but if you're in a poor state, that's just too bad. And what happens when you transfer? The same thing is what happens to K-12 when students transfer. You want to have 50 different educational systems. I see no reason why you cannot have the feds and the school. There's no value added whatsoever by a mid-level. Absolutely none whatsoever. No value added by adding that step or putting it here. Absolutely none whatsoever. There's something called economy of function. You don't need these anymore. As a matter of fact, you will end up with
bizarre, strange introductions that you wouldn't have at a higher level. Do they do this in other countries? Yes, they do. In France, if you go throughout the entire country, the curriculum is the same. It's even been said that you can go at any school at any given time during the week and you can tell what subject was being taught, what instruction was being given. But you want to have this hodgepodge of 50 or more, or everybody doing wildness, who knows what, I don't see how that benefits the system in any way, shape, or form. And also the fact, ALEC is a good example, the operation of them, they're giving, feeding this strange legislation, all written up, and all you have to do is put the name of the state into it. And they give the legislator some money and a piece of legislation, he introduces it, and he writes Illinois on the top, or he puts the name of the state, and this is the legislation we want. That's the reality of what's going on. If that's going on right now, you've got to keep this out of the states. Your states are not functioning properly. Yes, during the week, I just read the thing about the state where they have 10 state officials in prison at the same time. The 10 most recent high officials, they said they had a baseball team. This is one state. Now I come to a lecture telling me to do this. I know all about ALEC. As long as you have legislators introducing this strange legislation, they put some money and give them a piece of legislation, and then it's alien. Now the last thing I'd like to talk about is that there was a thing like, don't go to college, somehow the government is forcing, no, it's Tim's free market which is forcing people into college. And it just came out this week with the AFL-CIO. You don't have to go to college, but what is your option? Do you think there's a manufacturing job out there right now? Don't go to college. Tell the young person, don't go to college. And even the AFL-CIO will tell you this, there are no jobs out there that are going to pay you over $10 an hour. They don't exist. So that's the option you are presented, young person. Don't go to college and then make $10 an hour for the rest of your life. You don't have organized labor movement there generating these high manufacturing jobs. Don't you know that the jobs are leaving? Yes, productivity is up. Certainly the manufacturing is up. But that's the thing, people, Americans are even working longer hours. That's why they're putting in longer hours. We put in more hours than any other people employed on Earth. Why do you think they're doing that? Because they're making a lot of money and they just like to work? No, the wages have stagnated and they're probably gonna go lower. And as long as you're going to make it difficult or impossible for the organized labor movement to operate, there's no reason to believe that there's going to be any change in that in the upcoming future. Is there, in fact, a lock in the 114th Congress admittedly? Of course. But this Congress is going to change in 6 months or so, and then we won't be talking about it anymore. To change the framework of government, because this particular session of Congress at the federal level is not functioning, I think is a little surgically extreme. You're changing horses when you should just change riders or something like that. But those jobs, unfortunately, aren't out there anymore. And whether or not, also this public, I don't see this. Pell Grants have been administered since time began. Scholarships can be administered. That goes back years. There's no problem with those. And they were administered by the college. You didn't even need the state. Okay. You didn't go to a state official for any college financial thing. All right, thank you.
Andy, you're up out here. Oh, there he is. I thought he left.
Indiana.
6 minutes, Andy. Don't worry if you go a little over.
Okay, so it's all right.
Is it no good?
I agree with a lot of what Margaret had to say tonight. Obviously, it's hard to look at some of these things without a sense of humor as Captain Kirk used to introduce Star Trek, he said our five-year mission is to explore new life and new civilizations, to go where no man has gone before. Well, that's where we are today. We're in virgin territory. Almost, unless you're over 100 years old, nobody alive has seen anything like this political campaign with trying to bury Bernie Sanders, because it's not just, it's not Bernie Trump-like. Bernie is talking about things that go to the core of waking the country up to address the massive treason and criminal activity of the billionaire predators that own and operate our manservants. We have billionaire predators behind the scenes. You hardly ever hear their names. The Koch brothers are two of the more obvious that we do hear their names, that own and operate a whole stable of some of the highest paid criminal manservants on the planet. And these manservants of the billionaires are masquerading as our senators, our congressmen, some judges, some governors. Look at the governor of Michigan. Man should be serving life sentence in prison for what he's done for the crimes. Governor Rick, is it Rick Scott in Florida? His company, a healthcare company, paid $1.7 billion in fines for broken Medicare. We're watching criminals rise to the top and get into elected positions where they can shovel more money to their criminal friends. And Iceland is showing the world what it looks like when you put your bankers in jail rather than bail them out. The rest of the world, with countries that have universal health care, are showing what it looks like when your society has values that say clean air, clean water, affordable housing, decent food to eat, universal health care. These things should be basic human rights, not a privilege that if you can't afford, they just kick you off to live under a culvert and die. It's a national disgrace that we have veterans, homeless veterans, tens of thousands of them living in cardboard boxes or under viaducts or out in the woods, tents or whatever, because our country doesn't provide for them. The VA will provide for a homeless veteran. The VA will allow you to come in and sit in a wheelchair and wait to die. But to give you any help if you're struggling to pay for an apartment or anything else, the VA won't help you until you become homeless and you're in the gutter. I have firsthand experience in that, dealing with some friends. I said it before, Jim Hightower published it best in 2003. He wrote a book called Thieves in High Places. He said, look at the legislation those Republicans passed with Bush Cheney in the first 2 years. Just look at this list. And then ask yourself why there's so many sex scandals in the Republican Party. Well, to pass this kind of legislation, you need permits. Ordinary people with a personal conscience don't go anywhere near it. To do what the Republicans are doing, you need perverts. Psychological sexual perverts. That's why a high percentage of all the sex scandals in politics are on the Republican side. Because the Republicans have been quietly weeding out. If you have basic, decent ethics, morals, and conscience, you are in jeopardy of losing your job as a Republican. We will weed you out and run a pervert next to you in the primaries. And look it up in the dictionary. There's two definitions. One of them is sexual pervert, the other is psychological, right? And there's two definitions of prostitution also. One of them is selling sex, and one of them is doing what our politicians do. I've got to research it. If anybody knows this quote, Molly Ivins used to say, she was out in Texas, and there was a famous Texas congressman, I can't remember, it was 10 years ago, Molly would see him on this, you know, State House, Capitol. She'd say, Bill, how's it going? He said, I'm whoring just as fast as I can. I'm whoring just as fast as I can. That was his job. He reviewed the State House as one giant intellectual financial whorehouse. And that's what has become of many of the political state houses in this country. And the reason Bernie is being subjected to a media blackout is he's talking about issues that would matter to the middle class. He's talking about issues only incidentally, Michael Moore's movie was blacked out. Michael Moore's movie was suggested to a total blackout by the press, because if you go watch that movie, you'll say, this is a movie about what Bernie is campaigning about. All the good things that people have in other countries, universal health care, universal education, affordable housing, affordable daycare for the kids, 4 weeks vacation, what we used to consider basic, middle-class, decent amenities. Those things exist in many other countries around the world. And Bernie is waking people up. You see, you know, all we hear from the news is, and people that support Hillary, all we have to do is, that can't happen in America, we don't have the votes. One of the greatest pieces of political, one of the greatest things I ever saw was when Obama won the last vote. We voted the criminals out in 2008. We were voting for change. A lot of people weren't even voting for Obama. They were voting the criminals out. And this country gave the Democratic Party an overwhelming majority in the Senate and the Congress. They had a 60% veto proof, or filibuster proof vote in the Senate, and they got an overwhelming majority in the House. And right after they got elected, we started hearing voices coming out saying, we only have a 60-40 majority, and we don't have the votes to get anything done. Those mean Republicans want to filibuster and nothing to do about it. And now, the real cause of money behind what Ralph Nader has been calling the Demo Republican Party, one party with two faces. When you get disgusted with one face, they let us have another face. But it's the same billionaire criminals running it. We're seeing that with the billionaire shoveling money to the press and Hillary Clinton. They are force-feeding us Hillary as the level of disgust against Hillary is rising. Debbie Wasserman Schultz, well, she should be out just for the criminal activity she's been involved in. But she's the head of the Democratic National Committee, the DNC, I guess they call it, and the DNC. They've been lying about the votes. They've been lying about Bernie being behind. Bernie was ahead on the first night. Bernie won the first back in February. Bernie had 19 delegates to her zero. And then they just added in those superdelegates who hadn't voted yet. They don't legally have a right to vote until after the convention. But they've been adding those votes all this time, trying to discourage people from coming out to polls and voting. And I'll wrap this up. One commentator wrote an article about a week ago and said, he's like us, he's in his 60s. He says, I went to Beatles concerts. I went to Rolling Stone concerts. I've never seen lines of people standing in line, tens of thousands of people waiting to get into a venue, like what the people are turning out for running nationwide. The nation is waking up, and the fundamental injustice of unregulated capitalism, where no profit is enough. That's we have to do something about the billionaire predators, and the first step is talking about it. Realizing that this guy is not a legally elected governor, he's a criminal. And yet he massaged the votes. We have a whole bunch of people in this country that didn't get elected, they were put in office. Okay, thank you.
Feel the burn.
All right, any other rebutters?
Feel the burn.
Yes,
Margaret. All right, Margaret, you get the last word.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Feel the burn.
Like I said, you do what the Republicans did. You need perverts.
Kevin and the inspectors for mothers.
Let me put it this way. It's a good idea.
Jim was saying that markets. Where's the?
It's up there. Unwrap the. I'll help you, Margaret. I'll help you.
Are you ready for Hillary?
Oh, that's no problem.
That's a campaign.
There you go.
Are you ready for Hillary?
Okay, so Tim was saying that markets work. Actually, I agree with that, but my point was that the present practice of retaining profits just to pay out higher dividends is not helping much. And it should be used for raising wages and investment. So I believe in capitalism and markets, but let's see if we're working as opposed to. Also, Tim was referring to free trade as being helpful. He's completely correct. It's free trade that's brought many impoverished people around the world into the modern economy. We can't expect, you know, decade after decade, folks in China and India and all these other places to be peasants. They have a right to be part of the modern economy, too. That that we should be grateful for electric generation. Well, yeah, sure. I mean, anybody that's been around to historic houses like I have is glad we have electric lights and don't have to work by kerosene lamps or something. But we do have to have a better way of generating electricity and get rid of the coal. And let me say, and I think I've said this already, 40% of the coal produced in this country is on public lands run by the federal government. By the way, the federal government also is subsidizing the production of coal in Montana and Wyoming. Can you imagine that, subsidizing it? Now, the one thing that almost everybody realizes is that the place you start as far as controlling global warming is getting rid of the use of coal, which not only lets out more carbon dioxide than anything else, but also mercury and a few other bad things. Capitalism is a role in global warming. No, I mean, in a sense, but I mean, basically, you address this problem, as I say, by environmental measures, which the government should be doing, the federal government. Bad apple cops, I don't think it's fair to say we shouldn't get rid of bad apple cops. Yes, they are the problem, and I've read it many times, and many people have suggested that you have to get away from this cover-up culture they have in the police department of covering up wrongdoing, and get rid of these folks, just like in any job site. People are functioning right, they're fired. Medicaid under Obamacare. Yes, I agree there are some things good with Obamacare, providing Medicaid for the low income who can't afford. But if you're a bit higher than low income, you fall into this category. Excuse me one minute. You fall into this category if you're a bit too high of an income, and I don't remember the cutoff, to get Medicaid under Obamacare. Then you get to this category where you may have rent cases like this where you're paying $300 a month premium, let's say for a single person, and getting maybe $3,000 to $6,000 in deductibles. What in the world are you getting? You're being forced to come up with money and getting less than nothing. It's not right. I mean, unless you have a catastrophic illness, it can't be fair. And also, as women said, under Medicare, under Obamacare, you can't be denied coverage. Yes, that is a big improvement. Again, what I said about the federal government was that they should get out of the college business, medical business, and the food program. I don't say to get out of everything. I said, yeah, sure, they have functions, and somebody asked me, what are they doing wrong? And I listed them. I don't say they should collapse. No, we need a federal government, of course. You just have to rein it in. And the issue of, well, if you don't go to college and you won't get a job, well, wait a minute, did anybody hear what I said about the German example? And nobody is saying that you should just not have any post-secondary schooling. Of course you should, but get something, at least go to a technical college, but not a for-profit one, but a place that can actually give you the technical skills. Yes, you probably will need further schooling after high school, but not a four-year degree. And let me tell you, and I've read this too, there are many people that get out of high school that go into training to be, say, a heating technician. Well, they end up being far better in the long run than somebody that got a bachelor's degree in English, let me tell you. And, there is, and somebody was saying there's no regulation capitals. Yes, there is. Now, as I pointed out, and I'm concerned with this, that they're not regulating mergers these days, at least not in the bank, except not in the banking. And we are having mergers and acquisitions, and that's a trademark of the worst of capitalism. We have monopolies, as you do in Israel, for example. Inflation all over the place, a terrible place to very, very low wages, very high prices is terrible. The capitalist monopolies have taken over and it's bad news. You do not want to have that, and that should be regulated, and that's what I said. But they are doing regulations, as I said, but with
Dodd-Frank.
They are indeed, and I have read it in detail, how they are, at this point, at least in the Democratic administration, going after the banks. They are really regulating the big banks. There are other examples of some... There are other examples where, indeed, there is regulation. There's the Federal Trade Commission that does a good job, as I understand, and a few other, and the SEC does some good. So it is a fact that capitalism is totally unregulated in this country. That's not true.
All right.
And we thank you again for another good evening at the college tonight. And